Welcome to Michigan Out of Doors. I'm Jenny Olson, and this week we've got an all-new exciting show for you. We're going to start out by taking you over to beautiful Torch Lake, where we spent the better part of the day chasing after Atlantic salmon, and we got a couple other surprise fish in there as well. And Jimmy and the guys have some other fun stuff for us this week, too.
Well, that's right, Jenny. We do have a little bit more on this week's show, and we're going to do something that we really haven't done before. We're going to actually show you part of a documentary that was done in the Upper Peninsula by UP filmmaker Kristen Ojanimi. We're going to learn more about some deer camps that may have to be torn down in the Upper Peninsula. You won't want to miss that story. Lots of good stuff on this week's show. You stay tuned. I'm Jimmy Gretzinger. It's time for Michigan Out of Doors.
From the first spring rains to the soft summer breeze, dancing on the pine forest floor. The autumn colors catch your eyes, here come the crystal winter skies. It's Michigan, Michigan out of doors. Someday our children all will see this is their finest legacy, the wonder and the love of Michigan, as the wind comes whispering through the trees. The sweet smell of nature's in the air, Great Lakes to the quiet stream, shining like a sportsman's dream. It's a love of Michigan we all share.
Michigan Out of Doors is presented by Country Smokehouse, offering a variety of meat products. Country Smokehouse is located 3 miles south of I-69 on M53, just south of Imlay City. Country Smokehouse is a meat processor, a butcher, and a destination for sportsmen. By Meyer, a destination for hunting, fishing, and camping. From bug spray and tents to GPS and gas, Meyer has nearly everything you need to take on nature and get you there. Meyer. By Greenstone Farm Credit Services, making recreational land ownership possible across Michigan and Northeast Wisconsin. Begin your land financing journey at one of Greenstone's 37 locations or visit greenstonefcs.com.
We all have one. That perfect spot, a special place we go to smooth out the ripples of the day. Our perfect spot is calling. Our perfect spot is Pure Michigan. Your trip begins at Michigan.org.
Morning, guys.
Morning, how are
Morning.
You?
Good, how's it going, Jim?
Pretty good.
Yeah, what are we gonna do out here today?
Well, we're gonna catch some salmon and trout. Hopefully get into some browns, Atlantics, and a few Lakers.
How have you been doing out here?
It's been really, really decent so far this year.
Yeah.
Cold water, lots of fish scattered all over the place.
Oh, awesome.
So,
all right. What part of the lake will you fish?
The whole thing.
All right, yep. Who do we have with us?
We have Rob Cardinal with me. He's a good buddy of mine, and should be a pretty fun time out there this morning.
Cool.
Despite the thick fog out here this morning, Jim and Rob wasted no time getting set up across the lake. Jim had the game plan all dialed in for us.
Well, we're going to do quite a few things. We're going to do some deep water trolling with some downriggers, dipsies, and a different spread of lead core. That's primarily what we're going to do because there's a lot of deep water bait out there right now. Second thing we're going to do is we're going to try to get up on the beach area right at the drop-off. It goes from like 20 to a couple hundred feet, you know, pretty quickly. And the fish like to get up on top of that bank, so we're gonna put some small Rapalas up on high lines and just run them up in the shallow area. Put a couple in the shallows, couple off the drop-off at the same time.
After an hour with no hits, Jim switched up the plan.
Well, we trolled the beach. No luck, we did spot a couple on the way up through here, but no bites. Now we're going to go up and fish some deeper bait that we found off one of the points instead with some live minnows on lead core. So.
And I can see where we're going.
Yeah, fog's lifted. So now we can go for a long boat ride.
We motored back over to the east side of Torch Lake and got baited up.
What you got going here?
We're just hooking a minnow onto the lead core lines.
That's it? That's all you got going back there?
That's it. And then lead core. Yep, we're going to send it out. This is on a one color. It's got a leader, and we're gonna put a minnow out there, and they swim real nice.
Nice.
And we go super slow, like 0.8 miles an hour.
Jim found that pod of bait fish he was talking about, and things looked good.
So this is all bait right here?
It's all bait in the bottom, and then there's a fish above it.
That's a fish?
Yep.
Got one going?
No, really, yeah.
He's there.
Yeah, oh yeah, he's there.
He's there.
He's there.
He's there. Hook him up.
He's there.
Hook him up.
Got him. There he is.
You got him?
Got him.
Robbie, that inside one there, you probably want to move that.
Leave mommy just to yank it in?
Yeah.
How's it feel, Jim?
Feels like an Atlantic.
Does it?
Right. Coming right to the boat. Torch Lake has a pretty unique fishery. The DNR does stock landlocked Atlantics. Two different strains now. We get some from Lake Superior State, it's a small number, and then we get some from the Platte River, and they plant them here late in the fall.
And they can't leave?
They can't leave. They're landlocked because of the power dam in Elk Rapids. But they can get all the way Lake Bel Air, Intermediate River, all the way down to Elk Rapids.
Yeah! Woohoo!
That one.
Oh, nice.
That's an Atlantic.
Oh, we gotta hold him in the sun, man.
Look at this.
Beautiful.
He's got stuff on him.
Let me see that.
A little bug on him.
Oh, wow.
Parasite.
Cool.
Oh, cool. Beautiful fish.
Yeah, that's a nice one.
Oh, cool. So what did we get that one on?
That was on a one color with just a minnow.
That single minnow on a hook?
Yep, look at this. That's just good. A small trout bead hook is all we use out here.
Oh,
pretty cool.
Very cool. Yes.
One of the challenges Jim faces in guiding trips on Torch Lake is the fact that there aren't many anglers here to share information with.
You know, Torch Lake is one of those places where it's not fished real heavily for the size of it. I mean, there are guys who fish it, but the information is bleak, to say the least. All the information that I have is basically going off of what I did yesterday, day before, last year, year before, and it's challenging because it's something different every day. You got to look at things on your graph, you know, trust my electronics, I love that thing, and we just got to put the baits in the right spot.
Not quite sure, it's coming up to the top awful quick. There he is right out there. He's gonna be here real quick.
Brown. Oh,
nice brown. Slow us down a little bit, Jimmy.
Here, just bring him right here.
Awesome.
That's a pretty boy.
Nice brown trout.
Beautiful.
Beautiful, yeah. Torch Lake brown trout.
They're just gorgeous, huh?
Yes, they are.
Beautiful. So what'd you guys get that one on? You're trying something different out here, eh?
90 feet down on a Kevorkian spoon.
Wow. It's like big lake fishing.
Yep.
Oh, beautiful. Excellent.
That's a beautiful one.
With an Atlantic salmon and a brown trout in the boat, the guys had another fish on.
They're on the bite, eh?
Mm-hmm. Well, you can see on the graph, our surface temperature is 36 degrees, and we just hooked a fish 100 feet down.
What do you think you got there?
Pretty sure it's a lake trout. Characteristic head shake.
So you wanted to catch three different species when we set out today, and if this is a laker, that's the third species.
It's our third species.
Diver.
That's what he's on?
It's a streamer fly with this little disc in front of it. It's called a wiggle fin, and what it does is it gives this fly a Rapala-like action. Shakes it really, really cool.
So with yet another different kind of bait out there, Jim and Rob were able to connect with the third species of the day here on Torch Lake. With a lake trout on the line and headed to the boat, we were having a great day.
Cool. Deal. Getting into the fish now.
Yeah, we're getting them.
Torch Lake trout.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Oh, yeah.
That's a good one.
Well, you mixed up your technique a little bit.
I did.
Changed things up, and it worked out.
So far, so good, right?
Three fish, three different bait presentations.
Yeah, it has been. Sweet. No consistency. Normal day out on Torch Lake.
I'm not sure if there really is a normal day out here on Torch Lake, and that's part of its beauty. It's one of Michigan's finest crowning jewels, so whether you spend a day sightseeing on the shores or fishing with Jim out here on the water, make it a point to visit this incredible body of water in the northwest part of the Mitten. It will surely be a day you'll never forget, right here in Michigan's Out of Doors.
Well, in our next story on this week's program, we're going to take a look at UP filmmaker Kristen Ojanimi. She recently put together a documentary called Up a River, and it is really a fascinating story about a lot of UP deer camps that may have to be torn down by the beginning of 2017. It was a story that we've been hearing about for real over a year, and different magazines, different TV shows have mentioned it, but we wanted to sit down with her, get the real story about why she made the film, and really what may happen to these UP deer camps. For many a Michigan sportsman, deer camp, turkey camp, or fish camp all have one thing in common. Camp, the spot you get away to, where the distractions of everyday life just seem to fade away. We sat down with a filmmaker here in Michigan to find out more about what is happening to many a UP deer camp.
My name is Kristen Ojanimi, and I am producing a film called Up a River. It's about 100 or so hunting camps that have to be removed from the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. They are currently located in the Ottawa National Forest, and they have to be removed by January 1st, 2017. I decided to produce this documentary because I can't bring a million people out to these camps to show them what it is like to be at them and to meet the people that built them and that own them, that use them, that love them. And so by bringing my video camera out to all of these camps and interviewing these people and getting tours of their camps and for them to share stories about how much they love them, I can take that and turn that into a film, and I can show that to millions of people and show them why I think that these camps need to stay where they are.
2017, their camp has to be gone. So that's, we've got two more deer seasons here, this year and next year, and that's it. Then we gotta tear it down or burn it or whatever. And it's pretty sad, really.
In June of 1992, the sale was complete, and the Trust for Public Land transferred 30,693 acres of land to the United States Forest Service as part of the Ottawa National Forest. This land included 155 UPCO lease hunting camps.
The leases are still with UPCO, so they're not our leases. The land is our land, but not these leases. So we are administering the leases based on the terms of those leases, and we're honoring those, and we've continued to for almost 25 years, and that's been our intent from the beginning.
We are encouraged not to acquire land that have buildings or encumbrances on those. However, these particular pieces of land, this 30,000 acres, being right along a wild and scenic river and right in the very center of the Ottawa National Forest, it just made sense. And especially since we were working with the Trust for Public Lands, who worked with UPCO to, I think, to negotiate a 25-year non-renewable lease. So there was an endpoint for those cabins, and that land would be returned to a natural vegetation.
Why can't these camps stay where they are? The reason why the camps have to be removed by January 1st, 2017 is because they are currently on National Forest land. When they first built them, the land was owned by the Upper Peninsula Power Company, and in 1992, the power company sold the land to the Trust for Public Land, who in turn sold it to the United States National Forest as part of the Ottawa National Forest. And in that agreement, the leaseholders were given a 25-year non-renewable lease, in which that expires January 1st, 2017.
Would have to remove everything that they say is non-perishable. You know, your glass, or your stoves, anything. And everything we want that we put into this thing, as far as, you know, our mounts, our tape, you know, things that mean something to us. Even the lumber, like I say, came from my parents' property. If it comes to that, it's burning it down. That's gonna hurt.
I can't burn it. I could not burn this place. I plan on taking it. My plan is, I told Pete, I said, I'm 70 and he's 67, 68. I said, we're gonna take the camp down. We're gonna put it in my basement. We're gonna put the original camp would fit in my basement. I said, so I mean, I would love to do that in a way. Take the interior of my camp with the stove and the table and everything else and put it in my basement. And I'll call Pete and say, come on over, we're going to camp, and then we'll go downstairs.
Without the Forest Service help to do some road modification to allow us to break the camp into chunks and take it out on a lowboy or a trailer, if we could at least do that, it would be easier to comply with the terms of the lease. But under the current requirements, we're not allowed, and of course don't cut any trees or dig any holes or do any grading, and so it's going to be very difficult to get this camp down and get it out of here.
But we don't talk about it a whole lot just yet. I mean, we have a little, but and Lee has an exit strategy, I guess you'd call it.
But if they're calling it the end of it is the January 1st of the 17th, then we wouldn't be able to stay here deer season on the 16th. So our strategy is going to be just that, I guess. Tearing it down the 17th, or the year 17th. And bulldozing it, but I mean, other than a strategy, I guess that's everybody's strategy, isn't it?
Got 90 days after that to remove it, so I might wait till the 89th day, so we'll see.
But we understand that this is a pretty unique situation, and so I know we have made the commitment to help folks to make it as easy as possible so they can remove the materials from those camps. So if that means working with those folks to find the right season or to assist if there's some trees that need to be removed to get those camps out, we're willing to do that.
I would be honest with you, at my age, I'm not ready to build a new camp. You know, maybe these guys will build one, but then I'll go to their camp.
Growing up, I had no idea why we had to remove our camp. I didn't even really fully understand that we had to remove it until I got older. And even when I started this film a year and a half ago, I still didn't really have much of an idea why we had to remove our camp. It just didn't make sense, and everybody seemed to have a different answer and a different opinion. So it wasn't really until I actually sat down with the Forest Service that I really understood their reasoning as to why we have to remove these camps. I don't think it's a good reason, in my opinion. I think that the local Forest Service, they're just following their rules, what they are being told from DC. So they are being told that they cannot renew the leases, that they don't lease land. So therefore, they are just following the rules. And I don't see any compelling reason to do so. I think rules can be changed. And that's part of what I hope to solve with this documentary, is to change that rule.
If these camps do go, these roads aren't gonna be accessible to people to come in here and actually enjoy the river. Older people, they can't walk in here. It's a long way is in here. It's about two miles from any direction back out to a road.
And I know I had a friend of mine contact the Ironwood office of the Forest Service, and he asked them, well, you know, why do we have to remove these camps? And he was told by them, apparently, that, we're monopolizing the river, you know, this area has to be shared by everyone. If they're saying that we're monopolizing this area, I just can't agree with that. I mean, if anybody wants to come down here, they're more than welcome to come down here. Anybody wants to come down here and set up a tent anywhere near here, they're happy. They can come in and use my camp. I've got no issue with that at all, so I don't believe that excuse washes with me.
You know, it's so everybody else can use the land, and the land belongs to everybody, And I remember saying, well, I understand that. You know, we don't own it. We don't try to own it. We're just using it. We're just leasing it. We know that. You know, go out and find another place to hunt. It's basically what I was told. You know, they just don't understand. It's not that easy.
Their response when I inquired about it was that they don't have the authority. This forest doesn't have the authority to issue these types of leases.
They're not our leases to extend, even if we had the ability to extend, which we don't.
The Forest Service doesn't lease land anywhere. However, they do issue permits for special uses for on national forest lands, like ski resorts or other items where somebody has a use that's not a public use, or it's a use that's restricted in some form or fashion, and so that does occur.
One special use permit that exists on national forest lands across the country is a recreation residence permit. The Recreation Residence Program was instituted by Congress in 1915, in a time when Americans were being encouraged to get out and vacation in the national forests. Until the 1960s, private individuals were granted renewable permits to construct or maintain summer homes on designated tracts within the national forests for an annual fee.
But as time has passed, as the decades have passed, it's one of those things that we no longer need to try to get people to come to national forest lands. People do use them, they do love them, they recreate on them.
In 1976, a moratorium was placed on the program, and no new recreational residence permits were granted. Approximately 14,000 recreational residence cabins still exist on national forest lands across the country, 22 within the Ottawa National Forest.
We're following our policy as an agency. We're not the agency isn't establishing new recreation residence tracts. And so we aren't establishing anything like that because we don't have the authority to do that.
We're charged with managing that public land for the American public, and really our forest plan, which was written in 2006, is really our contract with the American people. So when we did put that out in draft form, we talked to that in the public. Not only local people, but people across the country responded and talked about what they hope to see in the Ottawa National Forest. And you know, as we move forward with projects, whether that's a timber sale or improving a recreational area, we always have to refer to that plan because that's what we contracted with the American people to do. And part of that plan says no new recreational residences. I mean, that's written right into the plan. And then when you look at that along with the leases that end in 2017, that's what we have made our commitments to.
These camps are also used by many others, some friends and some strangers, here in the wilds of the Upper Peninsula.
Camp logbook. Neighbors and some strangers that came to camp here, you know, and they stopped in and wrote a few words and left. And one is called Lurgis. We don't know who Lurgis is to this day yet. We'd like to know that one day, who Lurgis was.
We keep a log, and we like to write in whatever's going on. Like this weekend, Kim wrote in, Doc's birthday, Kim, Brandon, Tracy, Doc, Kyle out for the weekend. Last night we had burgers, hot dogs, pizza burgers, rain, and more rain. Today started out meeting with Kristen. I'll put a few more notes in before we go. We like to look back to our camp logs, and we keep track of deer we've shot and meals we've had and visitors that have come to see us. We get some old camp buddies that haven't been here in a while come in once in a while, so we keep track of all of that. It's fun to look back and see the memories in the books.
Special thanks to Kristen for letting us show a little bit of her documentary. If you'd like to find out more about this issue or get the full-length film, we will have Kristen's contact info in the credits of the show. The traditions of deer camp run deep, and the memories, well, they last a lifetime here in Michigan's Out of Doors.
Thanks for joining us this week for Michigan Out of Doors. Make sure you check us out online next time you get a chance. You can do it a couple of different ways on our website at MichiganOutofDoorsTV.com, where you can check out this week's episode again or older episodes if you'd like. You can also look up wild game recipes while you're there. Or you can visit us on our Facebook page at Michigan Out of Doors TV. We're on there every few days letting you know where we are and where we're headed next. Speaking of what's coming up your way next, we've got our big buck nights in store.
Well, that's right, Jenny. We do have our two big buck nights coming over the next couple of weeks. Next week's show will be Big Buck Night East from Novi. The following week will be Big Buck Night West from Grand Rapids. Lots of big deer and lots of big stories. Most importantly, you won't want to miss that. Lots of good stuff coming over the next few weeks. And if we don't see you in the woods or on the water, hopefully we'll see you right back here next week on your PBS station.
Michigan Out of Doors is presented by the Michigan chapters of Safari Club International. For over 40 years, SCI has been protecting hunters' rights and promoting wildlife conservation here in Michigan and around the world. SCI chapter locations can be found on the web at firstformichigan.org. By Vanguard, a global manufacturer based in Michigan featuring rifle scopes, binoculars, and spotting scopes with lifetime warranties. Vanguard supplies sporting optics and accessories for the outdoor enthusiast online at vanguardworld.com. By Pictured Rocks Boat Cruises of Munising, exploring Lake Superior's Pictured Rocks National Lakeshore with its sandstone cliffs, caves, waterfalls, and lighthouses. Pictured Rocks Boat Cruises on the web at picturedrocks.com. Closed captioning is provided by Marvo Mineral, makers of Lucky Buck. Deer management products including minerals to supplement deer diets year-round to improve health and antler growth.
When I want a far away, a dream stays with me night and day. It's the road that leads to my home state. I am a Michigan man. Changing seasons paint the scene like rainbow trout in a hidden stream. White-tailed deer in the tall pine trees. I am a